dear colleagues, the Rosa Luxemburg Foundation Brussels office welcomes you to this lecture of Dr. Pedro Paez. Pedro Paez was a minister for finances and economy of Ecuador and member of the UN Stiglitz Commission. And we are cooperating since 3 years, since the opening of the Foundation's office here in Brussels. And since we are here feeling this earthquakes and tremblings all the time about the crisis. So we were working already on the analysis of the crisis, and to give you a very short introduction on our point of view, we think that the measures the European Council is taking is no solution for this crisis, because it's fastening in a way the, let's say, the bubble economy of finances internationally, and it's no solution in a way that it is stabilizing the European economy and the, especially the situation of development and growth within the member states. So there's a lot to say about it from the inner view of our European Union, but what is really dangerous, we think, is that the central promise of the European Union to its citizens, the promise of wealth, is partly destroyed by this crisis. And another central issue of the European Union, the development of a European democracy, is in danger too. So we think it's rather important to continue to work and to try to find alternatives. Alternatives in terms of political transparency and development for Europe. Alternatives in terms of solidarity between European, let's say, still wealthy and not so wealthy countries. But what we could say nevertheless is this is not a homemade crisis. It's a crisis that is going far beyond. It's a world crisis. And so we enjoy very much to have Pedro Paez with us, who is working on the world crisis and financial and architecture since years, with his view from outside, which could help us to understand better and to develop alternatives. I'm very happy to introduce to you to Helmut Scholz, member of the European Parliament of the Left. And thank you very much that you are joining us. Perhaps you want to say some words to the audience too, Helmut?
First, I have to excuse for coming late, but I came, of course, also to hear Pedro Paez, who is a old fellow of us, a colleague who is working very hard on alternative ideas concerning the world currency system. And I guess that common good is one of the issues where we have to find alternatives in a way that this could show us a way out of the crisis. And maybe we have the chance to discuss certain issues on board people that's even afterwards, so I will not take the time for this, but I came just from Ecuador week before Easter, where we discussed the challenges
and the task concerning the further cooperation relationship between Ecuador as one of the countries with the European Union, and the will of both sides to find a new approach for the composition of the trade and commercial relationship between European Union and Ecuador in particular, and the contradictions which lay in the approach of the European Union side to ask Ecuador to follow the already concluded Peruvian and Colombian free trade agreement, association agreement, and the will of the Ecuadorian side to say, no, it should be not only a free trade agreement, but if there is an agreement, then this agreement must take into account common goods and the alternative development plan, so it should be an agreement about development and cooperation and trade. So we discuss it, and maybe that is also the part of our today's meeting to link the long-term perspective of creating alternatives with the political challenges we have to take into account by establishing bilateral relations in the current times. So let's start.
Thank you, Helmut. We pass the floor to Pedro Paez. His lecture will take about 45 minutes, and then we have the opportunity to discuss the central points of challenging analysis and your proposals for alternatives. Thank you, Pedro.
No, thank you very much to the Rosa Luxemburg Stiftung. Rosa Luxemburg Stiftung has been one of the most devoted fellows, comrades in this effort that we had deployed from Ecuador since 2008, and more specifically Birgit Diver, trying to create the widest network of people from the most different perspectives, political, religious, and geographical origins, in order to build up a new type of society, a new type of alternative to this structural crisis that we are living. And one of the key points of convergence has been precisely the theme of this meeting: common good. Common good and common goods in plural. And the role of money, the role of the new financial architecture that has been the perspective that we had presented. We have been fighting for this from Ecuador, that you know is not precisely the most, the heaviest geopolitical actor in Latin America, less so in the whole world. And do not have the resources to go through this type of proposals. But even though we had been able to present this idea, this agenda, in the middle of a very harsh intellectual and political environment in South America, now this is a reality, the new regional financial architecture. Last week, Banco del Sur, Bank of the South, the new institution called to be the key of the transformation of the developing banking, has started its operation. The new common currency in Latin America, Sucre, the unitarian system compensation, regional compensation, has already functioned for 2 years with a totally different perspective than the euro, with no neoliberal constraints, and not putting the car before the horses. We are not trying to sacrifice all type of policies in the altar of the money. We are on the contrary, creating the conditions from this new artifact, from this new creation, from this new instance of supranational decision and supranational policy space, the money, the common currency, for the enhancement of other national capabilities. We don't have this dichotomy between supranational sovereignty and national sovereignty. More so, we are building up conditions not only for supranational and national improvements, but also at the subnational and the popular conditions for agency, for sovereignty. And finally, we had already started this alternative to the International Monetary Fund, with a continental financial safety net that could prevent the possibility of the same type of speculative attacks that such a strong economy like the European one has suffered during the last years. And you know what? This is not all. The last meeting of BRICS in India, March 29th, has already adopted the same type of horizon for the construction of a new type of South-South cooperation. We had, in the middle of these negotiations that we had with the European Union, already in 2008, contacts with President Barroso, discussing the new type of possibilities also of a new type of North-South relationships, not based in this predatory scope of the free trade agreement, that at the end of the day is going to kill the golden egg goose, but another type of win-win relationships that could open the doors precisely for another environment for common good and for common goods, including the possibility of a multiplication of trade, a multiplication of job opportunities in both sides of the deal. Those are examples of a new perspective of what finance and what money should be. Those are not coming, unfortunately, from the textbooks, the traditional, the conventional textbooks of the mainstream economics. Those come from the long-term tradition in economics, in philosophy, in sociology, that are not, unfortunately, part of the day-to-day training and learning at the level of the universities. We have notions about common good and common goods since Saint Augustine and Aristotle in the Western tradition. We have, in the case of other type of societies like the indigenous peoples in Latin America, a long discussion about this type of issues, without naming it, without naming the notion of public good. Our societies, for millions of years, in the process of hominization, has been working for the common good of the society, of the noosphere. What appears now a huge problem, even in terms of the definition of what is good for the common, is a trouble because of the scission of the society, because of the conflicts in the society, because of the absurdity of the mechanisms of sociability. The problem is that the complex and rich grid of human relationships that eventually formalize themselves in terms of social relationships, most of them related to the realm of the sacred, most of them related to the realm of the myth, most of them related to the realm of the right, most of them related to the realm of the fetish, of the religious fetish. With the passing of time, with the evolution of the same noosphere, that means the intentional creative action of the human being in the society. This specific species that could transform permanently the niche, the ecological niche, that could revolutionize all the time the homeostasis with the rest of the environment, require some mechanisms of a recreation of the coherence between production and consumption. Some mechanisms of dynamic coherence in the relationship with the future. Some mechanisms of preservation, of creative preservation in the middle of uncertainty of a societal project. And this is not automatic. You know, during thousands of years, in this process of hominization, in this process of human evolution, those type of mechanisms were related to a political and religious institutionality. Sometimes out of the basic mechanisms of reason. Part of the capitalist modernity has been precisely the capability of introducing instrumental rationality in every realm of the society. But the key mechanisms of this transition has been the transference from this syntax of the religious fetish to the merchandise fetish and to the money fetish. And during the last few thousand years, and we have to be careful with these words, during the last few thousand years, human society has abandoned all other mechanisms of sociability, of recovering this coherence between production and consumption, between today and tomorrow, and to reduce all of those rich and complex human relationships in terms of money. So now the filter of efficiency, the filter of rationality and reasonability that is accepted by the society has to pass precisely through the functioning of money and finance. And that is why we decided to put an example of this situation in terms of what is happening now with the unfolding of the structural crisis of capitalism, specifically here in Europe. But this has to be taken as a global problem. So now, all the possibilities of reaction facing such huge challenges as we are going to see a little bit about the environmental crisis, about the fact, the quantitative, a qualitative fact that we are now 7 billion people, has to be resolved through the mechanisms that has been allowed by a system ruled by finance and money. That is the basic condition of sociability. So let me go into the details in order to present basically provocations and to create the conditions for the debate in the last half an hour. First of all, this what is happening now is not the complication of a financial crisis. What has been exploded or has been imploded during the last years are the remedies to the structural crisis that started 40 years ago. During the 60s, the boom, the golden years of capitalism, the most important rates of growth since the beginning of the humanity, of the recorded statistics of the humanity, ended because the convergence of several symptoms of an extended crisis of overproduction. Overproduction in terms of merchandises, but also overproduction in terms of capital. And you have here, I, I, I couldn't arrange statistics for the different sources here in Europe. There are methodological problems to do it, but you have here more or less the same type of graph of the installed capacity in the United States, and you can see the important change in the level of utilization of the industrial capacity in the United States in the middle, in the framework of a reduction in the dynamics of physical investment there. This is directly related to the problems of income distribution that we are going to go into the details in the North, but that has been the norm during the last years as the solution to this crisis of overproduction. And that is crazy. That is one of the main evidences of the incapacity of the current organization of the society based on money and finance to resolve the crisis. We have a problem of overproduction, and the basic response is to reduce markets through a process, generalized process of social polarization. You can see here the level of inequalities all around the world. This is within country inequality. So what you have in the North here is the concentration of the 1% the richest part of the population in the United States since the beginning of the last century. And you can see that the level of concentration of income after the Reaganomics is more or less the same than the concentration of income that created the other structural crisis during the 30s. But this is not a unique problem. That has happened in all the countries in the world. And you have only during the last decade, some mitigation of that process. So let's go into the details. What is the reason for this absurdity? How come we can solve a problem of lack of markets, overproduction crisis, with a systematic process of market asphyxiation? The key of the matter is that the motto, the engine of the movement of the society, the organization of the society, the organization of the solutions to the problems of the noosphere, come from the rate of profit. This is the line, this black line shows you the statistical approximation to the rate of profit in the United States, Japan, Germany, France, United Kingdom, and Italy. And you can see that since the 60s, as part of this problem of overproduction, you have a relative compression in terms of the relative prices of the rate of profit. That was only recovered after the application of the neoliberal policies since the end of the 70s, the 80s. Huh? However, an important part of that recovery of the rate of profit, of the profitability in the North, did not come out of the endogenous mechanisms. You can see here which was the tremendous transfer of excedent, of surplus, from the South through different mechanisms, among them the external debt. And all the connected macroeconomic responses in the South through the austerity policies that changed the terms of exchange of our products. I think it's very, very important for you here in the North to reflect on these type of issues, because the structural crisis of capitalism has reached such a point in which the metropolis are not colonizing only the South now, but they are colonizing now their own nation states, with the same type of recipes that they applied before to us. So, let's see what happened here in the North. Let's concentrate a little bit what happened in terms of the endogenous policies here in the North. One of the, we don't have time to show in the details the process, but just two main factors of the recovery of profitability in the North, here coming from the endogenous process in the North. You have a recovery of the rate of profit due to the compression of salaries in these white dots. And in this case, you have a reduction of the level of stagnation of the level of wages, opposite to what happened during the golden years of capitalism in the post-war. But you have an increase in the rate of consumption. So how is this possible to compress revenues and to increase consumption? Debt. The only way to do it is through debt. So there is no only moral issues or personal character weaknesses that have created this problem of over-indebtedness. Those are endogenous structural needs of capitalism. Without this process of indebtedness, the recession should start here. If the level of, if the rhythm, the evolution of consumption should follow the evolution of the revenues, the level of GDP growth in the North would be very dim since the 70s. So indebtedness is not a moral defect of the Greeks or Spaniards or the Portuguese or the Italians. That is a need of capitalism. The other side of the coin is what happens with this recovery of the rate of profit that we reproduce here from the last, the previous graph. Yeah, that is a very important result for capital, for the reason, the motto of capital, profitability. But the problem is that capital is condemned to recreate itself, to reinvest without any rest. This restless, compulsory behavior of capital, increasing itself, claiming each time higher and higher rates of profits, and each time in shorter and shorter periods of time, has created also a dead end for the system. Because there is no enough opportunities for productive investment now. And you can compare that situation with, in this black dot line, you can compare the evolution of productive physical investment. During the golden years, you have a correlation between the level of profitability and productive investment. Since the application of the neoliberal policies, you have this tremendous gap. So, where the money goes? What is the difference between profitability and investment, and productive investment? The irrational exuberance of Mr. Greenspan. Financial innovation. So it is not possible to return the genius to the bottle, as some people believe, only through re-regulation. Because we have a problem of over-accumulation of capital. And the whole future, the fate of humanity now, resides precisely here. We cannot decide as a society, and more so, we cannot decide this as a global society, as 7 billion human beings. We cannot decide what is good for the common, because everything passes through the filter of who controls power. And power is organized today through this type of mechanisms, residing upon the rate of profit. And this is the very severe situation that we most of the time refuse to accept. This is a problem of global denial. This is not a financial crisis. This is a crisis of civilization. We have several very urgent tasks to face. But we cannot do it because the problem of agency. Who is the historical subject that could undertake this type of challenges? Right now, who decides in the society is who decides the rhythm and the orientation of capital accumulation based upon the rate of profit. Again, one of the main indicators of the conjuncture has to do with the level of income distribution. It's the same graph that I presented before. Here is the level of income of revenue concentration of the United States in white. And again, you after the neoliberal policies, you have more or less this the level that produced the structural crisis of the 30s. But you have here the case of Europe. The gray one. And that is one of the reasons of the austerity policies. They need to catch up here in Europe. They need to provoke a very sharp income concentration in a very short period of time through austerity policies. The same type of policies, the same type of recipes that they provoke with the debt crisis in Latin America 30, 40 years ago. So the idea is to rapidly catch up with the level of social polarization that you have in the United States. There is no other rationality behind what is going on now in Europe. And again, we have to face very quickly a lot of challenges. But capital also has to face a lot of challenges, because so far has been the success of capitalism has been based upon the accessibility to cheap fossil energy. And you have a problem of peak oil and peak other type of sources of cheap energy. Not because there is an immediate absolute end of this type of sources and resources, but because the new type of discoveries are more and more expensive. And if the problem is profitability, we have a huge challenge that has not been assumed, has not been faced, over the mechanism that has been the success characteristic of capitalism during the last 500 years, innovation. The problem of overproduction has created a historical block to the rationality of capitalism. During the last decades, it has been more and more important the effort and the cost to prevent the diffusion of innovations in order to create monopoly than the rhythm of introduction of those innovations. But let's be very clear about this. We are not talking about the stop of technological innovation. What we are saying is that the arsenal of innovations is so humongous, and at the same time, the commercial application, the commercial deployment of those innovations is each time more and more sparse. Capital has created a lot of mechanisms, among them intellectual property. The basic strategic offensive of the United States and Europe in the free trade agreements as not being related to goods and trade, but what is called in the terminology of the WTO, the World Trade Organization, the Singapore issues, including intellectual property. That is a fancy name to create monopolies and to prevent the diffusion of innovation. In the statistics of research and development of the United States, that has been one of the main factors of the leadership of the United States during the last decades, one-third of research and development expenses in the United States is devoted to juridical suits, litigation. They had closed NASA, they had closed a lot of the leading programs in terms of science and technology, and they had devoted more and more resources to this type of mechanisms preventing the diffusion of these possibilities. And in the case of energy, we have, well, in the case of the continental Europe, specifically in the case of Germany, you have an important, almost marginal, but important development in terms of new technologies. In the case of the United States, all the evolution, all the flourishing of initiatives of alternative energy during the 60s and the 70s was bought up by the largest transnationals of oil and finance. We had lost 30 years of technological innovations to face this type of ecological challenges because the logic of blocking innovation, creation of monopoly, and the alternative in terms of profitability, geopolitics, and war. The conundrum of the Middle East, the conundrum of the geopolitical situation today is not related to communism versus capitalism. That was the alibi 40 years ago. Now it's very clear that everything has to do with oil. The humanitarian imperialism in terms of Libya, in terms of what is happening now in Syria, the planification of the invasion of Syria and the military aggression in the aftermath of Iran, and maybe also in Latin America, has to do with raw materials, and more specifically, hydrocarbons. Oil. The hypocrisy of the humanitarian imperialism is just a disguise for oil and financial interests. And we have plenty of possibilities, of technological possibilities, based on the real free trade. We should talk about free trade in this type of realms in order to prevent war, in order to promote peace. But this is not in the agenda of the oligarchical and imperial powers. And we are facing an immediate challenge in this situation, not because of the traditional vision of peak oil, but because in terms of the input-output energy measurement, in terms of the energy throughput, we have lost the advantage that created the basis for the rapid growth during the last century. You have in the 30s the relationship of the units of energy reduced to the same measure. The correspondence between the units of energy that you need, in this case in red, to produce the equivalent to one barrel of oil was this level. In the 70s, that was deteriorating smoothly, but the evolution of this during the last decades, especially since the 90s had assumed an exponential negative trend. And that could mean that today the amount of energy, independently of the relative prices, that could be manipulated around the geostrategical moves and the financial manipulations, this is inexorable. The relationship now is more or less in this area. And all the perspectives under the current technological paradigms that have been blocked during the last decades because of the logic and the dictatorship of profitability, of monopolic profitability, could present a very sharp situation in terms of conflict and tension. The dispute, the geostrategical dispute, has a very sharp scenario of exacerbation. Okay. So we have this situation. Instead of the rhythm of technological innovation that has been the triumphal card of capitalism during the last, the civilizatory triumph of capitalism during the last centuries, we have a very fast accumulation of the trends in relative terms, not in absolute terms, in relative terms, of this other type of expedients in terms of monopoly and in terms of geostrategic solutions. So the convergence of all these factors have created a new type of logic. You can see here the statistics about, in black, about the growth, the evolution of the real economy, global GDP. And since the application of the neoliberal policies, you have not only a very sharp reduction in the average rate of growth of GDP, but also much larger volatility. The IMF has realized an inventory of the financial crisis during the since the application of the neoliberal policies. And they had counted, until before the crisis, until 2007, 267 financial crises, compared with something like 27, 28 during the golden years of capitalism. So we are not talking about the black swan, so typical of the mainstream economics. This is not a rare occurrence. 267 crises imply that financial crises are acting as a structurant factor of a relation of power. Those are a norm, a constant of this new way of existence of capitalism, the neoliberal capitalism, the globalized, financialized type of capitalism. 267 financial crises before this crisis. So this is very important. And in comparison to this, you have in orange the growth of financial derivatives. And it is not a coincidence that you cannot find exhaustive, reliable statistics about the real amount of financial derivatives in the world. So we have a change of epoch, a change of times, a change in the structural change in the dynamic of capitalism, from the real economy, from the productive capital, to the speculative capital. The predominance of the logic of rent-seeking mechanisms and the hypertrophy of the speculative apparatus. Now, the global GDP, just to have an approximated idea of the magnitude, the real GDP, the global level, is $63 trillion. The normal debt, that means public debt, enterprise debt and household debt in the world is $212 trillion. This is serious. It's almost more than three times the size of the real economy. But the new debt, the financial derivatives, amount to almost $1,500 trillion. That means that with all the tricks, with all type of bailouts, explicit and implicit bailouts, with all the corruption of the regulatory agencies, with the complicity of the government, with all this type of mechanism of neocolonization of the South and even here in the same North to extract surplus from the population in order to bail out permanently in a chronic way to the financial system, to the bankers that created this crisis. We should have to prevent the 7 billion human beings to eat during 25 years. And it is not possible to pay the debt. This is not an opinion. You can go bank by bank. JP Morgan Chase has $93 trillion in the balance sheet. Of course, off balance, because that is part of the paradox. That's part of the same type of absurdities that we are talking about. Bank of America, $75 trillion. So each one of those banks had debts that amount for several times the global GDP. And the European banks had the same type of troubles. None of those debts has been taken into account in the official stress tests. None of those debts had been taken into account in the evaluation of the situation, both of the financial and the non-financial enterprises. None of those debts had been taken into account in the real evaluation of the situation of the countries. Nothing of this is part of the evaluation of the rating agencies. And each time, these cycles that had occurred during the last 4 or 5 years had created a situation in which the emission, the issue of more titles, of more financial titles, had less and less to do with fresh productive capital, what is called in financial terms initial public offerings. So that means that all the functioning of the financial indicators, the Dow Jones, the Nasdaq, the European indicators of the city of London, the Frankfurt market, the France, the Paris bourse, has nothing to do each time with the real economy, with the physical productive investment. We are creating all the signs, all the symptoms supposedly related to the recovery of the economy are basically feeding the monster, are increasing the size of this self-reference system of speculation. So let me show you how important is this proportion, this location, not only in quantitative terms, this 63 versus 1500 trillion dollars. No, it's also in qualitative terms. For example, just to illustrate the situation, and we can go into the questions into the details. But the global imbalances that are in some way a reflection of the problems and the disproportionalities of the real economy, no, show you this type of situations. You have a chronic debt, a chronic deficit in the United States, and a recent deficit in Europe that was supposed to be financed by the savings of China and other emerging economies. That was more or less the dominant discourse in terms of the conventional macroeconomics. Okay? Pay attention to this. This was supposed to be the source of the extent of the debt, of the public debt of the governments, the United States, Japan, Western Europe, and other developing countries, and other countries in the world. The problem is that those levels, that those unsustainable levels, have to be paid according to the picking order. Like what happened during the 80s with the debt crisis in Latin America. Or even previous to that, the destruction of the nation state control construction in the independent Africa. Look carefully this type of problems, because as Birgit said before, the crisis in the continental Europe is not an endogenous crisis. Europe is part of the structural crisis of capitalism since the 60s, but the specific financial crisis, the specific public debt crisis that has been created recently corresponds to this situation. In the aggregate, that is the level of indebtedness of Europe. Source of the, or that is recreated and is exacerbated by this type of deficits. But in the reality, the relationship, the situation of continental Europe has nothing to do with the situation of, for example, United Kingdom or Japan and the United States. So, of course, Greece has a lot of problems. But the size of Greece is equivalent to the size of Alabama in the United States. And Alabama has been bankrupt during the last 15 years. And nobody has talked about the destruction of the United States and the failure of the dollar on the, or the exit of Alabama from the Union. Spain, of course, had a lot of troubles. But think in relative terms. Spain had a much better fiscal performance than Germany until 2008. 3-4 years ago, nobody could imagine that this crisis was going to engulf the whole European Union. 2 years ago, that was a problem of Greece, Portugal, Ireland. Now it's Greece, Portugal, Ireland, Spain, Italy, and who knows if tomorrow that includes France, Belgium, and maybe Germany. Where are the main markets for the success, the export success of Germany? Here, and maybe China, but China is another issue that maybe we can address during the questions. Okay, so look carefully to these last graphs. Those are the reasons from the real economy to the problem of debt. Those are the geopolitical aspects of the current discussion here in Europe. But this is what happened in the effective financial flows. So this is, those are the financial flows in 1999. And the size of the arrows shows the direction and the magnitude of the transactions, and you cannot see at all any important arrow from China and India to the United States. But you cannot see those either in 2007. The basic transactions, the basic flows of financial transactions are within the financial centers themselves, Wall Street, the city, Frankfurt, Paris, Hong Kong, Tokyo, and among them, both in 2007 and 1999. There is no correspondence to the global imbalance that are the obsession of the macroeconomists, of the gurus of economy. That is what you are discussing in the European Parliament. That is the key of the blaming game between the United States, China, Germany, etc., etc., and the currency wars that are happening right now. Nothing of this is at the core of the actual functioning of the financial system. Nothing of this is at the core of the real dynamics of the noosphere, of the society. Human society has to face a lot of challenges, and none of those challenges are in the priorities of the real power. None of those challenges, none nor the common good, are part of the decisions or the priorities of the real powers. We can go into the details, we don't have too much time, about the importance of these new actors, the BRICS, the emerging economies, the new role of finance in general in the economy, and the multipolarity of this situation, but controlled by the so-called Anglo-American financial circuit, not because the main banks are Anglo-American, but because this is a school of banking, different, for example, of the Renanian type of banking, to say something. But you have, for example, in the case of the United States, 8,400 banks, and only a handful of banks are part, of course, the most important ones, are part of the so-called Anglo-American banking circuit. And you have, on the other hand, very important financial institutions here in the continental Europe, or in Japan, or in Hong Kong, that are part of this network of financing, whose more important strategy of reproduction is related to financial speculation, to financial derivatives. Opposite to the other type of financial reproduction that came from a specific relationship between productive capital, including monopolic productive capital, and finance. The historical real concept of investment banking, not the Goldman Sachs type of investment banking. Okay, so we can go into the details if you are interested. Just to show you this, the result of this situation is the growing importance of financial profits in the GDP, in the North, in this case the United States, with relationship to the GDP, the actual economy, and the other type of activities profits. And to show how fast that has been reflected in terms of capital accumulation, capital concentration and centralization, power accumulation. Out of this database of 2007 of 37 million companies, legal information that you can access, we are not talking about the tax havens. The connections, this is a graph coming out of topology. There are some techniques in which you can organize the information in order to see the connections among corporations. 147 control out of 37 million, 147 control 40% of the GDP. I insist, without taking into account the phantom enterprises, the triangulation in the Bahamas, in the Jersey Island, in the Cayman Islands, in Gibraltar, in other type of tax havens. This is the explicit information. And here you have the 50 most important transnationals. You can detect here either the banks themselves, the same banks that out of corruption and incompetence created the crisis, or the main stockholders. And you can see here in one partial audit of the Central Bank of the United States, the Federal Reserve, that was published in July the last year, who was the beneficiary of the $16 trillion bailout. And you can see the same financial institutions, not all of them American ones. The lender of last resort, contrary to any conventional textbook of economics, of macroeconomics, of finance, of banking, has nothing to do with the national institutions. Nothing of this is, strictly speaking, part of the national law of the United States. So every figure that was published before, every official figure, 0.7 of the TARP, Mr. Hank Paulson going to the Senate of the United States, or 1.6 or $2.7 trillion has been truth. The truth has been $16 trillion, more than 100% of the GDP. And the University of Kansas City, Missouri, has completed this figure, not the exhaustive figure, but this is just a partial figure. It's just one program, the Troubled Asset Relief Program. The amount of resources that has been poured into the banks has been collected up to $29 trillion. And the question is, what has been solved with all those resources? You know, $29 trillion is the equivalent to the annual income of 97% of the global population. That is the key of the discussion between money and public good, money and the good of the common. How are we going to solve this type of issues? We have presented, and this is the final, a series of situations that has in around the notion of the new financial architecture. I mentioned this at the beginning. Now we are in the middle of a very sharp geostrategical dispute between the rent-seeking predominance of the future in the north, in the old core of the system, and the new industrial allocation in the emerging countries, including Russia and China. On one hand, there is a possibility of solving the situation with international cooperation. The real free trade, not the free trade agreements, not the World Trade Organization philosophy, but the real free trade. And on the other hand, you have more speculation, more destabilization, war. We have, in the middle of this dilemma, a very sharp transformation of power. For archaic, the return of capital to archaic forms of exploitation, the return of power to archaic forms of domination. This is happening very, very quickly. We have to create conditions to reassume power, to empower people at the level of the communities, at the level of the sectional governments, at the level of the national governments, at the level of these new horizons of integration, at the level of a multipolar world, in order to prevent the further concentration of power in this oligarchical and imperialist agenda, whose only horizon goes to more war, destabilization, dismantling of social conquest. We can prevent this degradation of civilization upon the basis of a lot of possibilities that you can find in the institutions that, for example, you already have here in Europe. In Latin America, we had created this new financial architecture as one of the premises for this empowerment of the new governments, of the new progressive policies. I'm sure that we can discuss, we can create the conditions at the level of the policy making circles, at the level of the universities, at the level of the intelligence, in order to search for solutions. We are 7 billion human beings. We are 7 billion brains that we can think of solutions. Let's democratize the process, and for sure we are going to find the solution. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Pedro. So the floor is open to discuss how do we get from the part to being a problem as Europe to being part of the solution.
Central banks, be it European central banks or whatever, central banks should be allowed to lend directly to the states, which would prevent to go from states to go to the markets. And we believe that this would be a systemic change, not being obliged to go to the markets. It's only a part of the solution, but that could be, we believe, a part of the solution. And by taking over the control of the, that is for the state situation, but also for the private, persons borrowing for the buying an apartment or whatever, or corporations. Also, the principle of having public banks who do not lend money for speculation, but would lend money for specific socially, environmentally sound purposes. Controlling these financial institutions would be a key to the development of the new strategies, economical and social strategies. That is a part. Another part, I think, is important, is to reduce, we have now a bubble, a financial and monetary huge amount of money, of credit, which is balanced by a huge amount, same amount of debt. You cannot have credit without debt. So it's there now. So the second then, besides taking control of the money production, also we must find a way to reduce these huge amounts, which are a social problem. This could be done through, that is, just an idea, but some economists, bring up these ideas through a process of inflation, which would reduce the relative importance of the monetary assets or taxation on wealth, etc. So we have to find ways to reduce the importance of these things. Okay. Then this IMS would like to have your opinions on these two aspects.
Immediately? Okay. Unfortunately, most of the debate so far, including in the progressive and heterodox circles, including ATTAC, for example, but also including academic circles far away from the orthodoxy, have been prisoner of a myth. How come it is technically responsible and theoretically sound to pour trillions of dollars, trillions of euros in the same speculative circles that created the crisis, out of corruption, out of incompetence, creating these speculative bubbles, creating this speculative hypertrophy? And how come it's totally irresponsible and populist and totally ignorant to propose resources for full employment policies? for the development of science, technology, for environmentally friendly projects, for conviviality projects, including the possibility of the integration of minorities, the promotion of new members of the society, etc., etc. Where is the theory behind this? Who says that if the government produces new projects for the good of the community, for the common good, this is inflationary? But it's not inflationary to inject $29 trillion in the same banks that created the crisis. More so, what's supposed to be, and the economists had this as kind of the law of God, that if you increase the monetary aggregates, you had an immediate relationship in terms of inflation. So we more than doubled the amount of the monetary mass during the last years. And where is the inflation? Where is the inflation? It was supposed to be 1-to-1. Where are these $29 trillion of liquidity injection in the United States in terms of inflation? Where are the bailouts here in Europe in terms of inflation? And nobody says anything about this in the economics profession. There is nothing about this in the text of macroeconomics. Who talks about this in the programs of finance and economic debates in the television or in the press? Nobody. So we need to start changing our subjective perspective. We have plenty of possibilities. Here in Europe, just for example, without changing the constitutional framework of the European Union, there are plenty of possibilities. Without changing even the current mandate of the European Central Bank, there are possibilities to finance projects for the governments. And without changing the legislation, there are plenty of possibilities to work in alternative mechanisms of financing at the national governments, but also at the sectional governments. It has been done already. You know, we don't have time to go into the details. Greece, Ireland, had issued currency without the knowledge of the population, not necessarily for the good purposes. Napoli had created a local currency. And now everything is possible to do with the discipline of the electronic system of payments. We have done this in Ecuador. We have done this in Latin America. The banks are creating money all the time. 97% of the monetary aggregates are issued by the banks privately, not by the central banks. An important fraction of the central banks are not state-owned, are not national banks, are private banks, are private corporations. So everything that we have in our heads about what is going on in terms of money and finance has been distorted. We have to study, we have to discuss openly, without taboos, without a priori dequalifications. The solution for Europe is here, right now. You are not condemned to follow the same path to destruction that we had in Latin America.
Traditional public services and public goods we have in Europe, to hold on decent work and stability from this, to deprivatize at least partly the banking system, to go to public and into the what ATTAC is proposing on public banking. And I think it's necessary. What you said, I think this is an ongoing debate on the so-called Eurobonds, that states don't have to loan money from private banking. There are some measures, I think, that are already even also in the European Parliament in the debate. But what I see as one of our problems is that the governments are going in another direction. The governments with the fiscal, my impression is simply that they are in a kind of panic and selling out the still wealthy European citizens' goods. So perhaps Helmut, you can say something about the debates in the European Parliament, but what is very clear from your explanations, I think that we have to connect our debates and our seeking for alternatives with the international debates, and not only to look on our small Europe, because it's only one, let's say, one region within all these kind of circuits. But what I find really the what is really fear, bringing me in a situation of fear, that is that every step our governments are making to with the bailouts of the banks, with the contributions they are giving to Greece, with this, it's all going to the banking systems, to the banks, to the private banks, and all this money is going into this speculative circle that is destructing the productive sources of all of us. It's destructing even the productive parts of the capital, of the, all. I remember when we are part of the Finance Watch network that was created here on the European level. And in the Finance Watch network, there are many, many organizations from small and middle-sized enterprises, from public services organizations, and so on. It's not only public banks and so on, but it's all these who don't have any more a space to move to develop that is under this threat of this kind of politics. So perhaps Helmut, you could give something about the critical position in the European Parliament that is at least could be at least a more rational institution to develop. And then, if you have questions, please feel free, comments on yes.
First of all, I would thank to Pedro for this input. I mean, you want to speak first. I will not speak about the discussions in the European Parliament, because I think there are more important questions you just have raised in your introductory contribution to this discussion, to this debate we have here. But what I want to say is, you have said we cannot decide as society what. And you have asked what is it the European Parliament is discussing. So that leads us to the question, who are the actors? Who are the subjects of deciding on all these issues? And that leads me to one problem that even have heard a lot of debates in Ecuador concerning the Sucre's regional integration, the role of the Sucre, etc., etc., in a dollarized country, or a country which is dollarized currency. So that means, if you are speaking about subjects, who is deciding, then the European Parliament